Republican Senator Bob Corker, who is retiring soon, took to the Senate floor to lash out at his fellow Republicans after party leaders blocked his bill to give Congress veto power over certain tariffs imposed by President Trump. Corker accused the GOP of cowering to the president.
And a lot of them would vote for it if it came to vote. But no, no, no. Gosh, we might poke the bear. It's a language I've been hearing in the hallways. We might poke the bear. The president might get upset with us as United States senators if we vote on the Corker Amendment. So we're going to do everything we can to block it. Well, we'll do what we can do, but my gosh, if the president gets upset with us, then we might not be in the majority. And so let's don't do anything that might upset the president.
All right, let's discuss all of this with CNN political commentator Scott Jennings and Anna Navarro. Great to see both of you. Scott, are Republicans afraid of President Trump?
Well, I think Republicans want unity with President Trump because politics is a team sport, and unity has produced results, and good results in Washington means good politics for the midterms. What Senator Corker is trying to do here is attach an amendment to a bill that would kill the bill. This is a defense bill, by the way. The amendment would be vetoed by President Trump anyway, and all in the name of blowing up the relationship that Mitch McConnell and the Senate Republicans have built with the White House over the last several months that Republicans are happy with. So I think there's a better venue for this. I understand Corker's point. I'm not a huge fan of tariffs, but this was the wrong venue for this tantrum.
Anna, how do you see his message?
You know, I think it's too little too late, frankly. It's, I'm sorry to see that leaders in the Senate, like Corker, get retirement time courage. Look, I think we are having a deficiency of consistency in Washington and a deficiency of courage, particularly in the Republican Party. Is there reason for it? Yes. Take a look at what happened last night with Mark Sanford. He lost his primary. This is a guy who in Congress has spoken up against and opposed the president at times, even though he's voted with him 75% of the time. Yesterday, Donald Trump tweeted against him, just in the middle of the election, and he lost his primary. So I think that after they see people like Mark Sanford fall on their sword, you're going to see even more cowering, even more cowardice by the Republicans in Congress.
Hey, Scott, I want to move on to the different tone and words that President Trump is using to talk about historically our allies, like Canada, and then Kim Jong-un, who, you know, up until yesterday was considered a murderous dictator who imprisons tens of thousands of his people in gulags and starves them. So listen to this juxtaposition.
He gave out a little bit of an obnoxious thing. I actually like Justin. You know, I think he's good. I like him. But he shouldn't have done that. That was a mistake.
We have developed a very special bond.
He is very talented. Anybody that takes over a situation like he did at 26 years of age and is able to run it and run it tough.
All right. So actually, I think he used stronger language against Justin Trudeau, Prime Minister of Canada, than we played right there. He just called him weak, other insults. And then with Kim Jong-un, he just said yesterday, he's successful, he's smart, he's funny, he loves his people. Are you troubled, Scott, by the words that the president is using with these different leaders?
No, I think the president views all these things very similarly. These are transactional issues for him, and I think on any given day, if he thinks that slamming you is going to get him what he wants, he will do it. If he thinks that flattering you is going to get him what he wants, he will do it. He has flattered Trudeau, he has attacked Trudeau, he has attacked Kim Jong-un. He has flattered Kim Jong-un. I think he believes that these things are all part of some elaborate negotiation and that at any given time he can change his attitude if he thinks that will bring you closer to what he's trying to achieve for the American people. So I would expect this relationship with both leaders, frankly, to go hot and cold as the president sees fit as it relates to his strategy on negotiating.
Anna, do you have any problem with President Trump saying that Kim Jong-un loves his people?
Of course I do. Take a look at what the people of North Korea look like. Take a look at the suffering that they're going through. He is a cruel dictator. Look, I don't have an issue with Trump meeting with Kim Jong-un. And I think, I'm not sure that there was an option. If I was sitting in Hawaii right now and thinking about and fearing nuclear bomb drills, I would say it's a good thing that they are meeting and hopefully something can happen. But words matter. It's one thing to meet from a position of strength, like Ronald Reagan often did, and it's another thing to go to North Korea, you know, or South Singapore and practically, you know, just butter him up like if he was a butterball turkey. I mean, this thing was just pretty gross. And you know, Allison, I'm kind of really proud that I'm one of the people on TV today that does not have to bend herself into pretzel shapes, which is a good thing because I ain't as flexible as I used to be 5 years ago. I couldn't deal with Obama palling around and going to a baseball game and having popcorn with Raul Castro, who is a ruthless dictator. Well, ruthless dictator is ruthless dictator. Americans should not legitimize. American presidents should not use the platform to legitimize and normalize a ruthless dictator, whether it is of the left, whether it is of the right, whether it is in Cuba, whether it is in North Korea. It is not about partisanship. It is about American values. It is about what is right and wrong. And so people who are today saying they are okay with Trump palling around with a North Korean dictator who oppresses his people, but 2 years ago were criticizing Obama, shame on them, and vice versa.
What about that hypocrisy, Scott?
I think that there's a huge difference between the Cuba situation and North Korea, and that is North Korea is aiming nuclear weapons at us. Mm-hmm. And I don't think the president's palling around with Kim Jong-un. I think he's trying to defang Kim Jong-un. I think he's trying to denuclearize the peninsula.
Wildly,
and I think he's trying to break a...
He's wildly flattered.
Yeah, and this is what he does. We've seen him do it in Washington. We saw him do it before he got into politics. This is the way he handles these negotiations. Now, look, we're at the beginning of a process that may or may not work out. And yeah. I am fully aware that the North Koreans may lie the way they've lied to us for decades. But I'm willing to give peace a chance, and I think we ought to give the president some rope here to see if he can break a logjam that's been decades in the making by a political establishment that has banged its head against the wall.
Got it. But, Scott, just so that we compare apples to apples, you know that there was huge outcry from Republicans, from conservative media, when President Obama, then Barack Obama, I think he was a candidate, dared to suggest that he might meet with a dictator or North Korea without preconditions. So how do you square that?
Yeah, nobody trusted Obama to do the right thing. And guess what? It was borne out. The fears about Obama were borne out. I mean, how about the Syrian red line that he drew and was crossed and did nothing about? I think people trust Trump more than they trust Obama to deal with these people.
When he suggested that he would meet with North Korea, there was hue and cry. When President Trump suggested that he would meet with North Korea, there was applause. Just explain it.
Yeah, I think the explanation is it's the president's duty to protect us as the American people from nuclear war. Uh-huh. He believed we were on the brink of nuclear war. We're farther away from that today than we were. Is all of this perfect? No. Is all of this rhetoric perfect? No. This is a messy situation, but if you want to be farther away from war, then today's a better day than it was last
summer. 10 seconds to wrap it up.
Yeah, it's a two-word explanation, tribal partisanship. My guy does it, it's okay. When the other guy does it, it's terrible.
I know. I mean, that is exactly where
we are. A dictator is a dictator is a dictator. Tell the Cuban people and tell the North Koreans that there is a difference.
Well, Anna Navarro, thank you.
We need less nuclear weapons on that peninsula.
I root for American values. I will not compromise them because there is a Republican in office.
Okay. On that note, thank you both very much for that debate.